Thank you. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Kubernetes HAProxy talk. Today, I will describe how we migrated our cloud-based microservices infrastructure to Kubernetes infrastructure and what role HAProxy played in it. Before that, let me introduce myself again, maybe in my company I worked in. So yes, I have both experience in software development and platform engineering, which helps me to popularize this kind of DevOps culture and practices in company. I live in Ukraine. We have a big community of engineers, and I'm co-organizing our DevOps Digest newsletter, which runs monthly. And I work now as a staff software engineer at thredUP. thredUP is the biggest consignment and thrift store in the world. We have we process about 100,000 secondhand items daily, and we have about 300 million items available for sale every time online. We have a lot of distribution centers, which is powered by automation. You can see it on the video. And all this is run by software and platforms that run this software. In terms of engineering team, thredUP is not so big. We have about 70 software engineers. We run about 50 microservices applications, and everything is about on 100 EC2 nodes in AWS. We have Ruby, we have Node.js, we have Python, and we explore in more programming languages like Java and so on. And we started in 2009 as monolithic application written in Ruby on Rails, running on one dedicated server. But with the time pass, we grow as a company, and we migrated to microservice architecture, deployed in Amazon Cloud. And here is where HAProxy came into play, because it acts as our main routing point, delivering requests from a bunch of microservices based on request array prefix, based on host names, and so on. But with time counts, we decided to containerize our application, and we were looking for unified deployment platform for containers, and Kubernetes seemed to be the right solution. And we wanted we had this type of architecture and infrastructure, and we wanted to get this type of infrastructure where every service is kind of abstracted by Kubernetes service. And so on. So we begin our migration, and actually we did it. We did it within a year. We even have a case study on Cloud Native Computing Foundation, and we receive a lot of gains from it. We not only like unified our deployment process, and we also received a big hardware decrease, because it's about 50%. We improved performance, we improved scalability of our services, and you can read about it here. But the actual point is that during the migration, like, we have to support this type of infrastructure. We have, when you have your old one, when you have your new one, it's two separate networks, and you have HAProxy load balancing between it. And I will describe you our migration plan and migration process, and I will give you some examples of issues and gains we bumped, and how we solved it. So our migration plan, it looks actually like pretty simple. So if you have a service and you have it functioning on EC2, you need to prepare Kubernetes deployment, and for that you need to containerize it, maybe do some tweaks in code base to prepare it to be container ready. You write Docker file, you update your continuous deployment pipelines, and after that, you test it in Kubernetes environment. Does it deploy? Does it actually container runs? And if everything is okay, you deploy to staging cluster, you verify it works, you verify it functions, it can communicate to other services. And sounds like simple process, but I think everyone knows, like, you can bump in a lot of issues during these steps. But if everything goes okay, and when eventually you fixed everything, you deploy to production. And in terms of production, I think a lot of familiar with like blue-green deployment is when you route some small amount percent of traffic on your new deployment. Like in this, we have like 2%. Below, you can find a backend configuration for such initiative. And after that, you run your test, you analyze logs, you analyze errors, and if everything is okay, you switch like 100%. And you may want to use your old deployment as a backup. You can see it from configuration, you add a backup option. In case of something happens, you can switch back. But the case is like classical blue-green deployment is that you deploy new release and old release, you have it in the pretty well-known environment. It's your production environment, and you run it daily, like deploy and deploy. And in our case, like Kubernetes was completely new to us, and it was completely new, and we didn't know how our service can react and what can happen. So we started with like cookie-based routing. Is when you in client, you specify cookie, and you configure your backend service in that way that it serves requests to the new release only if you have this cookie specified. And in that case, you can manually do some integration automatic test. You can verify that this new release in new environment, it works and function at least close to your old production service release. After that, you can do pretty much the same like weighted routing for the service. But in our classical blue-green deployment version, we did like 2%, 100%. This way, we decided that we can't go so fast, and we do gradual weight increase on our new Kubernetes deployment. So for single service, this kind of weighted pass would be different, but it's just an example. Like you take 2, 10, then 20, 50, and you still have your cookie set if you want to test some, if you want client to talk to Kubernetes service directly for your test reasons. But here it goes. And not to mention like, okay, we did test with all this cookie routing. We did tests all this weight-based routing increase in load, and everything works perfectly okay. We switch it 100% to Kubernetes-based service. But you still, it's good practice to leave your old deployment as a backup. And also there may be not a very convenient point that you have support your deployment pipelines to deploy on both old and new infrastructure. And we bumped in such cases when we have, for example, 2 days of new Kubernetes service functioning normally. And then something happens, you have downtime, and having these backup options and your old infrastructure is really good point. We investigated, we fixed, we are back to Kubernetes service, but having this for, I would say, for 2 weeks maybe, your old deployment as a backup strategy is a good point. And okay, so it was our migration plan. It was our path for migrating as example of single service from the old infrastructure to Kubernetes cluster. And it sounds like success. And yes, it was success. But the actual thing that during this path, it wasn't so straightforward. And we bumped in a lot of issues. And I will name a few connected with maybe HAProxy config, with connectivity. And the first one is in Kubernetes, if you deploy it in Amazon, the service is represented by a load balancer. And during this gradual traffic increase on our newly deployed service, we started to notice that we have downtimes and service become unavailable. We switch it back to the old one and to the backup service. And we started to investigate, and it seems like AWS does autoscaling out of the box and behind the scenes, and it works perfectly, but it does it in a way that during the autoscaling, it changes IP addresses behind your load balancer DNS name. And in our case, like HAProxy, we didn't do like dynamic resolvers. And in our case, during autoscaling, HAProxy on the start resolves your DNS load balancer name to specific IP addresses. And when AWS ELB scales, we get new IP addresses, and old IP addresses is unavailable. And so we have service downtime. The solution is pretty simple from HAProxy configuration standpoint. You have to define dynamic resolvers. You have to specify your AWS DNS name server. You configure like cache load time, lifetime retries, and everything like that. And you specify these resolvers on the backend. And after that, everything works smoothly. You don't have any downtimes. And it was an unpleasant case when we experienced problems, but we quickly solved it. But it's worth to mention that you can have it, and please use dynamic resolvers. I think it considers like not only AWS, it considers every cloud-based provider. And even if you have a DNS name in your backend on servers, and if you plan to change IP addresses behind it, please take it into account and use it. Okay. The other, not to mention, point, like when you deploy your server, when you do migration of your service to Kubernetes, you probably have your dependent services deployed in the old infrastructure. And during this migration, you have to communicate with both this new one and the old one. And maintaining two deployments, like new one and old one, simultaneously makes you to provide connectivity with, for example, the database layer from Kubernetes and from your old infrastructure. And the point is your old data layer and dependent services is probably deployed in the old infrastructure. And when you do deployment, you set up, for example, Kubernetes in this single separate network. And it's not so easy to connect to these resources. Of course, eventually, you migrate everything to a new network, to a new platform, and it includes databases and everything like that. But during the migration, you have to, as I said, you have to maintain it simultaneously. So, and the good point that we already had HAProxy deployed in the production network, in the old infrastructure, and we decided, hey, why not to use it as a proxy? And just to define a couple more front ends for database, for Elastic File System, for example, which we use regularly, and to use it as a temporary solution for the routing, to just to configure firewall to enable access for these resources only from Kubernetes network. And this way, you can maintain this connectivity and have these temporary problems solved really fast and in a secure and reliable way. That's it. Okay, like you migrate services, you do it like day to day, and sometimes you see that it's not go so well, and monitoring seems to be a good place to look and to look for metrics and to see if everything goes well. HAProxy provides you with a bunch of metrics, like, and we use Datadog as monitoring dashboards. We use like 200 errors, like 500 errors, and it seems it was very useful. For example, if you migrate a service and you notice like increase of 500 errors, you can dive in and investigate further. Apart from that, we used a lot metrics like response times from HAProxy to the backend and from the HAProxy to the client. And sometimes it gives us a lot of benefits to notice problem immediately and to fix it. I will name one, like what is the downside of Kubernetes, if we can say so? Because if you deploy your service on like dedicated hardware, is it like bare metal or cloud-based, you just reserve a EC2 instance with fixed capacity, you know how much memory it has, how much CPU it has, and you use it, and your service works on that instance, and everything is okay. If you need more, you provision more. In Kubernetes, for example, if service starts to consume more resources than you expected, it could be a noisy neighbor for other services. And yes, we have this resource management, like you set up fixed capacity for a service, and sometimes you try to investigate, okay, what it will be if I reduce service. Maybe this service doesn't need so much resources. And you actually reduce. You can see like we reduced like memory footprint and which service requests, and we noticed it like latency increasing 10 times like immediately. So HAProxy metrics helps us with monitoring and to prevent such like experiments and bad experiments from going to production. That's it. I will also tell you like about our configuration management, because like during this migration you have to update HAProxy configs a lot, maybe even multiple times a day. And we decided that it's not good to do it by hands and to do it by just verifying like from other engineers, and it's good to use configuration management. So we store all HAProxy configs in GitHub, and we use pull request to review so we can verify, and having two couple of eyes at least is a good point to verify everything works perfectly. And when we do pull request merged, we update our continuous integration pipelines in that way that we provision configuration on all our HAProxy servers. And this way, we could do migration in kind of predictable, reliable, and secure way. So that's it. As I said, we succeeded in migration. HAProxy helped us a lot doing it reliably and in predictable way. And if you have some questions, I'm ready to answer. Like, and thank you very much.